Hello students, once again welcome you all to the class of physics. So in this video I am going to start another topic, that is work done by adiabatic process. Work done by adiabatic process. You already know what is the meaning of adiabatic process. So it is nothing but, in adiabatic process actually what happens, so here there is no exchange of heat between the system and the surrounding. So that is what we are going to study here in this concept. So if it is that case, so what will be the work done? Okay, that is what we are going to find out here in this session. Now, in the previous video, we studied and also we derived an expression for work done by isothermal process. As I told you, it is very, very important for your examination for 3 to 5 marks, depends. And probably this question they have not asked till now in your exam, but you can't say that this is not important. They may ask this year, okay. So, but the concept is very, very important. You must remember this one. As I told you in the beginning itself, this adiabatic process is nothing but there is no exchange of heat between the system and the surrounding, correct? So now if it is that case, let us consider one mole of a gas. So how it will looks like if you consider if you want to see an experimental setup. So there we can take the complete cylinder, which is made up of what? It is made up of perfectly insulating material or conducting wall, including the base. Why, sir? Because whatever the heat you supply from outside, it is not going inside the cylinder, correct? So whatever the work you do on the system or by the system, so there will be no exchange of heat between the system and the surrounding. Okay, so then what is the variable, sir? All three will get changes. See, if you apply pressure, so if you push the piston, what happens? The volume will get increases or it decreases. The intermolecular collision, the gas molecule, they will get collide with one another. Because of that, pressure will get increased, temperature rises up. All these things we can observe here in this case. Okay, so when we consider the statement of first law of thermodynamics, what does it says? The amount of heat supplied to the system is utilized to increase the internal energy of the system, and remaining amount of heat it is used to do external work, correct? So we have an equation, that is dq is equals to du plus dw. So what do you mean by du? Increase in the internal energy, dw external work, dq is nothing but amount of heat supplied, correct? So here if you take in this adiabatic process, what happens? There is no exchange of heat, so this value will become zero. Okay, because this one you already know, you already studied. Now what we will get here, if you want to find the value of work done, correct? We need to find the value of work done during adiabatic process. So dw is equals to what? Sorry, I'll write one more step. Dw plus du is equals to zero. Now dw is equals to, when you send this into the RHS, it will become minus du. Okay, so this will be the condition. Now actually we know the value of du in the previous, not in the previous video, before that we discussed the applications of first law of thermodynamics. There we got the expression for change in internal energy, external work, as well as the amount of heat supplied. I'll write here dq is equals to, there we got cp into dt. Similarly du is equals to, there we got cv into dt. Here also dw we already know, that is p into dv, or we can say r into dt. So later we found the value. So either you can use this or this, depends. So but here I'm not going to take that. We need these two values, because Cp we already know the molar specific heat capacity at constant pressure, and Cv value is also we know, that is molar specific heat capacity at constant volume. Now what I'll do, I'll substitute the value of du here. So dw is equals to what, minus of, what is the value of du? Cv into dt. So Cv into dt. So this is what the equation we got here. So here what is the variable? The temperature is the variable, correct? Now let us later we can find the value. So how will be the total work done we are supposed to find? Okay. So now here I just want to find the value of total work done by the gas adiabatically with, from the temperature rises from where to where? Temperature rises from T1 to T2. During this temperature, what will be the total work done, sir? Why you took sir T? Because see here, T is the variable, that is nothing but temperature, correct? So as I told you in the previous concept itself, if you want to find the value of total amount of work done, so what you need to do, you have to do integration for the given function. Now we have dW here, correct? Substitute that. So dW is equal, so I'll write most step. So minus Cv into dt. Now I want to find the total work done. Integrate on both sides. So integration, integrate on both sides. Minus Cv into dt. Okay. So where the temperature ranges from T1 to T2. The range temperature value from T1 to T2, correct? Now that is equals to, take minus outside, that is Cv. So we don't know what is the value of Cv, correct? Do you know what is the value of Cv? That we don't know, later we'll discuss that. So T1 to T2 into Cv into dt. So see, if you want to integrate this function, here the variable is dt, here we have Cv. What do you mean by Cv? That is nothing but the molar specific heat capacity at constant volume, correct? So dt is the variable, you take dt directly. So what I can write, I'll take the Cv as constant, take it outside. Sir, why we need to take that Cv outside, sir? Later we can substitute it and we can simplify that, I'll tell you. So Cv, what you'll get, minus Cv into integration T1 to T2 into dt. So integration of dt is what? That is t. Minus Cv into dt is t. That is limit from T1 to T2. Correct? Now let me write one more step. So now this is W. Total work done. W is equal to minus Cv into. Now we can apply the upper limits as well as lower limits. So what is the upper limit here? It is T2. I can write the equation as T2 minus T1. So here we got, or I can write it as Cv into, take this minus inside the bracket, what I will get? Minus T2 plus T1. I will write it as T1 minus T2. So now W is equals to Cv into T1 minus T2. So take it as equation number 1. Sir, what is the value of Cv? We don't know what is the value of Cv, sir. Then what to do? See, now actually we have a value, that is we know the relation. So what is the relation between Cv and some other terms? See, here we know all these three are variable, like pressure, volume and temperature, correct? Now we have a relation between Cp and Cv. What is the relation? Cp minus Cv is equals to R, correct? Where R is the universal gas constant. So what I'll do, divide this LHS and RHS by Cv. Divide LHS and RHS by Cv. Why, sir? Because I need to find the value of Cv. Or you can write it as Cv is equals to what? Cp by Cp minus R. There pressure term is also there. Then it will be difficult for us to find the value there and substitute here. So what I'll do, I'll eliminate Cp. How to eliminate? I'll tell you. divide both side by CV. So what you will get, CP by CV minus CV by CV is equals to R by CV. So this will get cancelled. What I will get, CP by CV minus 1, that is equals to R by CV. So what is the value of this CP by CV? The molar specific heat capacity at constant pressure to the molar specific heat capacity at constant volume. So what is that physical quantity? That is nothing but gamma. We can take it as gamma. We know that, we already studied in thermal properties of matter in that chapter, correct? Now gamma minus 1 is equals to R by CV. So just send this CV into the LHS, bring this gamma minus 1 into the RHS. So what I will get, CV is equals to R divided by gamma minus 1. So now here we got the value of gamma. Take it as equation number 2. Actually what we need here, we need to find the value of CV, correct? We got the value of CV. Okay, so R by gamma minus 1. Now we got the value of CV, then what else is required? Nothing, just substitute the value of CV in this equation. Let me substitute. Now substitute the value of 2 in equation number 1. So what I will get, W is equals to CV. What is the value of CV now? R divided by gamma minus 1 into T1 minus T2. So this will be the expression for work done by the gas during adiabatic process. In adiabatic process, the work done by the gas is given by R divided by gamma minus 1 into T1 minus T2. So this will be the concept. See, sir, here we took, this is for what? 1 mole of a gas. This is for 1 mole of a gas. For n moles of gas, for n moles of gas, n mole of a gas, we have a formula, that is W is given by, that is total work done, that is N into R. I'm so happy to write this because this is my initial, you know, right? Yeah. So now N into R divided by gamma minus 1 into T1 minus T2. So this will be the final expression for the work done by the gas during adiabatic process. Okay, so this is one of the very, very important topic. Okay, so what and all we can explain here, sir. See, when will be the value of work done by the gas is positive in adiabatic process? See, W is work done by the gas is positive, or we can say when a gas expand adiabatically, if it is expands, then the value of T1 must be greater than T2. Work done by the gas is positive when the values T1 is greater than T2. So you can substitute here. If it is T1 is less than T2, here you will get negative. Then it is negative, correct? Work done on the gas. Then we can say work done on the system. So here, if you want to explain, if it is work done by the system, then the value of temperature T1 must be greater than T2. Why? Because here we have a equation T1 minus T2. Correct? So now, this will be the one condition. So this we can say, the gas is expand adiabatically. If it is expands adiabatically, then work done by the gas is positive, then the value of T1 must be greater than T2. So similarly, the work done is negative. When will be the value of work done is negative? If T1 is less than T2, then we can say it will compress. the gas is compressed, then the work done by the gas is negative. Okay, so this will be the formula, and this is very very important. You all must remember these formulas. Okay, so this is for what? 1 mole of a gas. If you consider n moles of a gas, so this will be the formula. Okay, so this is all about the work done by adiabatic process. The next we are going to study, the first law of zeroth law is done, and first law is done. Next I am going to take the second law of thermodynamics. Sir, what do you mean by second law of thermodynamics? Still we have laws. Yes, we have. Okay, see what does it states. So before going to that, let me tell you one thing. See, we know that in generally, what, sir? See, heat flows always from region of higher temperature to lower temperature. That is what we studied till now. Okay, so which and all the laws we have, sir? We have so many laws that we studied in thermal properties as well as in thermodynamics. Correct. So how can you prove this? Okay, so do we have any laws to say heat will not flow from region of lower temperature to higher temperature? Yes, we have. That is what we are going to study next. Okay, so that is nothing but second law of thermodynamics. Okay, we'll see what do you mean by second law of thermodynamics. Okay, students, once again welcome back. Yeah, actually we started to study the work done by isothermal as well as adiabatic process. That is done now. As I told you, we have another law of thermodynamics. That is nothing but second law of thermodynamics. So what does it state? See, we have first law. See, there are two laws actually, not two laws, one law, but there are two statements given by two different scientists. The first one is Clausius statement. See, just read the statement once, then you will understand. I'll explain. So if they ask in your exam, write the statement of second law of thermodynamics. You can write anyone, that is fine. Or particularly if they ask, write the Clausius statement or write the Kelvin Planck statement, then you have to write either this, whatever they asked. Okay, what they asked, that is what, that only you are supposed to write. Okay, see here we have, as I told you, we have two statements. The first one is Clausius statement. So what does it state? See, it is impossible for a self-acting machine unaided by an external agency to transfer heat from a body at a lower temperature to a body at higher temperature. It's very simple. The meaning is, as I told you in the beginning, so it's difficult for a body to transfer heat from a region of lower temperature to higher temperature. So it is, that is that we can't. When we can, if we have an external agency, with the help of some external agent or external agency, by using that we can transfer heat from region of lower temperature to higher temperature. But in other cases, there is no need of any external agency to transfer heat from higher temperature to lower temperature. Correct. There is a easy exchange of heat between the system and the surrounding. That is nothing but hotter body to colder body. Heat lost by the body is equal to heat gained by the body. That is, heat lost by the hot substance is equal to heat gained by the cold substance. That is, we already studied in calorimetry. Correct. Calorimeter. So there we studied the in thermal properties. But here the meaning is, we are not supposed to transfer heat energy from a region of lower temperature to the higher temperature. If we want to transfer, we need some external support, that is unaided by external agency. Okay, so that is what the meaning of Clausius statement, that is second law of thermodynamics. And we have another statement, that is Kelvin Planck statement. So what does it states? Okay, so just read the statement. See, it is impossible to get continuous supply of work by cooling a body to a temperature below the coldest of the surroundings. I'll repeat. It is impossible to get continuous supply of work by cooling a body to a temperature below the coldest of its surroundings. So what does it means? See, if you want to do some work, so what you need to do, you have to, for example, let us take a heat engine. If you are supposed to do some work during by using an heat engine, so we have to take heat from the hot reservoir and we have to do certain amount of work, and some amount of heat will goes to the cold reservoir. Okay, so there is no continuous amount of work, or we can say we can't say 100% work will be done in heat engine, whatever the system you take. So we can't expect 100% efficiency. So when you will get the 100% efficiency, whatever the heat you supply to the system, it is completely, if it is converted into work, completely if it is converted into work, then we can say the efficiency is 100%. But if we don't have such engines or such heat engines or such materials in our daily life, what we are using, we don't have any such kind of materials, efficiency is not 100%. Okay, so here also the same thing. It is impossible to get continuous supply of work by cooling a body to a temperature below the coldest of its surrounding. If the temperature of the body is less than its surrounding, then we can't do work. We can't do continuous work. Then what we need to do? Obviously, we have to take heat from the hot reservoir. Then we have to do some work. And the rest of the heat will goes to the cold reservoir. So this is how it actually goes on. So these two are the two different statements of second law of thermodynamics. They may ask in your exam for 1 mark or they will ask 2 mark. Write the second law of thermodynamics. Write the two statements of second law of thermodynamics. If they ask like that, you have to write both the statements. Or if they ask it for only 1 mark, the question, if it comes like write the statement of second law of thermodynamics, you can write anyone, fine. Or particularly if they mention, write the Clausius statement as well as Kelvin-Planck statement, you are supposed to write the which one they will ask. Okay, so based on that question you are supposed to answer. So this is all about second law of thermodynamics and the work done by isothermal process, adiabatic process. All these concepts are completed. So if you have any doubts, you can ask. Just send your doubts in a group. There we will discuss. Okay. So in the next video, I am going to discuss another topic, that is nothing but heat engine. So what is heat engine? What is the efficiency of heat engine? What are the different parts we can observe in case of heat engine? And what is Carnot engine? What is Carnot cycle? So all these things we are going to discuss in the next class.